Blackstone Audio presents And There I'll Be a Soldier, a Western story by Johnny D. Boggs. This book is read by Chris Abell. For Mark McGee. Foreword. My ancestors fought on both sides of the Civil War, a fact my deeply Southern relatives never bragged about when I was a kid. Come to think of it, many still don't up to that Yankee bit of family lore. Maybe that's why I started out with the idea of writing a novel told from Northern and Southern viewpoints about the Battle of Shiloh, which of course is no stranger to novelists, Will Henry, G. Clifton Whistler, and Shelby Foote, for example. Yet when a research trip brought me to Corinth, Mississippi, I decided to include the second Corinth battle in this narrative as well. Shiloh is Shiloh, with countless historians analyzing it, while Corinth is often overlooked. Corinth also was a direct contrast to Shiloh. Shiloh was fought in fields and woods, while Corinth took place in a town. Walking around Corinth, a wonderful town with well-preserved history, I was struck with the need to add a third voice to the mix, that of a non-combatant Southern citizen. After all, the war certainly affected civilians and not just soldiers. Thus, Grace Denner was born. Grace Denner, Texian Ryan McCalla, and Missourian Caleb Cole are products of my imagination. But many other figures in this novel did fight for the North and South, and many of those died or carried the scars earned at Shiloh and Corinth in 1862. Chapter 1, August 6, 1861, Putnam County, Missouri. He stood ankle-deep in pig dung, slogging through a pen filled with squealing Duroc's and snorting Poland Chinas. Even with his rubber boots and thick gloves, he knew he'd stink for the rest of the week since one of those ill-tempered big red hogs had charged and knocked him onto his hindquarters. Probably would carry the stench the rest of his life. So when Jimmy Crawford came riding up the road, Caleb welcomed the chance to climb out of the muck and sit on the top rail, maybe catch a breeze in the sweltering heat, but at least escape the stink for a while. "What you doing?" Jimmy called out after reining to a stop. In lieu of a saddle, the lanky teen sat on a worn woolen blanket, and instead of a bridle, he used a horsehair-hitched hackamore. "What's it look like?" Caleb Cole shook his head. Jimmy shot a worried glance at the house. "Your pa around?" Caleb shook his head. "He went off this morning to Bryant Station to haggle with Mr. Metzger." Haggle, Caleb thought with disgust, over another big red Duroc. As if we don't have enough already. "Bessie, your ma?" He didn't bother to answer. "Why aren't you working at the sawmill?" Jimmy Crawford sat up straighter, blue eyes straining first toward the cabin and then across the coal farm. He wore duck trousers, a sweat-stained blue shirt, and no hat. He wiped sweat off his brow and lowered his voice.
"Ezra Meacham says some Rebs are recruiting and drilling at Unionville."
The mule snorted.
"Your pa's been preaching abolition and the Union forever since you moved here," Caleb reminded his friend and neighbor. "I know that."
Another quick look to make sure nobody could overhear him, which irked Caleb. These hogs, sows, and piglets wouldn't tell anyone what Jimmy Crawford had planned.
"But I figured it couldn't hurt to go watch them. Be fun and downright interesting. Thought you might like to tag along with me and see for yourself."
Now it was Caleb's turn to look at the house. Smoke wafted from the cook shack's chimney. Chickens pecked the ground in front of the porch, but he couldn't see his mother or sister. He looked down the path that led to the Putnam County Pike and scanned the rolling prairie. That would be just like his father to come home right now. Although he saw nobody, at length Caleb sighed.
"I can't go." "You got something better to do today?"
Jimmy grinned and pointed his jaw at the sea of red, black and white swine crowding the pen. Caleb dropped to the ground, but kept his left hand on the top rail, like it would anchor him to his chores.
"Ezra said they were drilling right on the courthouse lawn," Jimmy said. "That takes gumption."
Putnam County was spitting distance from the Iowa border, and residents had changed the name of the county seat to Unionville from Harmony a few years back. Maybe the rebels wanted to rub secession in everybody's face.
Jimmy's head bobbed. Yeah, but Ezra up and joined the Southern cause. Says so did Parker Pruitt and a couple other boys he didn't know.
Caleb lifted his left hand from the fence, using the bottom cedar rail to scrape mud and manure off his boots.
You planning on joining?
A rough laugh caused Jimmy to lean back on the mule. When he straightened, he said,
Are you joshing me, Caleb? My pa would skin me alive if I turned secesh. I just figured it sure had to be funner than sawing logs.
Or slopping hogs, he prodded on.
Bet we could even stop at Witt's Mercantile for some sassafras tea after watching the Rebs.
Looking at the clear blue sky, Jimmy added thoughtfully, I imagine Marianne's working there today. Caleb had taken a couple steps away from the pen. His lips parted and he wet them with his tongue. Then his head shook.
I'm not fit to see Marianne, or anybody in Unionville.
Jimmy countered.
You can wash off at the creek. Clothes will be dry by the time you walk to Unionville.
By then, Caleb already knew he was going. He stood 6'1" and weighed better than 190 pounds, too big for a whipping from his father, and his mother wouldn't mind. Bessie would give him grief, but no matter what he did, she'd find some excuse to needle him. Besides, he reasoned, his parents and sister would like to hear his report. Most likely, Pa would be perturbed that he hadn't gotten to see a rebel militia in Unionville, rather than just another red stud hog in Bryant Station. Likewise, Jimmy Crawford knew that Caleb would tag along.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.